Thank you so much, Shri Hassan Khan Saab. Honorable MP Ladakh has highlighted the importance for a cordial relations between the two nations. And also, Honorable MP has highlighted that there is no conflict between the two nations in their ideology. And Honorable MP has also highlighted that unity in diversity are the chief features of our Indian nations. With these trends, before calling upon our Honorable Chief Guest, I would like to make an announcement that there is a student MP introduction. We have arranged an introduction between the students and Honorable MP. So we request you all to attend that session after this seminar. With this now, I benignly request our Honorable Chair, Dr. S.S. Bolaria sir, to deliver his presidential address. Dr. Bolaria sir.
Share my views on the topic as chief guest. But I was also asked to chair this session. So I think as the chairman of the session, I have to complete one duty, because it is customary that in all seminars at the end of all the speeches, if there are any doubts or questions or clarifications that the audience want, there's a time fix for that. My problem is that we've already overshot the time. So if you agree with me, we'll have 15 minutes question answer session. And you're welcome to ask any questions. I'll make only three requests. One, please introduce yourself. Secondly, ask the question and don't make a statement. And thirdly, please also nominate the speaker to whom the question has been addressed. If you all agree with that, for the next 15 minutes, we can have the question answer session. Is that okay?
Yes, sir. Koi sawal, koi bhi karna chahta ho, apna naam.
अगर सवाल नहीं होगा तो मैं आपको बोर करना शुरू कर दूंगा अपनी स्पीच से. ओके प्लीज गो
अहेड. What is the role of Persian literature in strengthening Indo-Arab relations?
Persian literature. I think Professor is the ideal person to.
What is the role of Persian literature in strengthening Indo-Arab
relations? Persian literature. हाँ बैठे बैठे माइक उधर ही आ जाएगा. That's a very, very interesting question. Thank you very much for asking. Yeah.
Persian language has enriched Urdu language immensely. Persian language has given refinement of the culture and the mode of life. Persian language has a rich poetical mind, which is full of philosophy and wisdom. And on the portal of United Nations, United Nations, there is the verse from Sadi, from Sheikh Sadi. The verse is inscribed here. I have seen it with my own eyes. In New York, United Nations Court. The verse is, Bani Adam Azai Yak Taikaran, Idara Farinish Zayak Jamharan, that human beings are born of, made of one substance, and in their construction they are like the limbs and part of the body. So if one limb is in pain, the entire body is in pain. So you cannot imagine wisdom better than this, spoken for humanity anyway. This is one of the contributions of Persian language, not only to Urdu language, but entire humanity.
Next question, please. Yes, we have a friend there in red t-shirt.
India and Iran make effort in this relation in contributing in science and technology, supplying gears and labors to each country, so they can, apart from education sector, they can make lots of other sectors so that the relations can be maintained between the two countries. Thank you.
Well, the last question is over, but there is a law of equity. All the three questions come from this side. So can we please have one question from the right side also?
Right.
Yes, yes. Sorry, but I will have two questions because the gentleman raised his hand first before you. Kindly go ahead, kindly go ahead.
My question is slightly different. Sir, as for this international relation concern, because we all think that it's, every country has just played a power game. So I think that soon we have just, you know, too much interest in the Iran oil, I think. So as for that, we are just, we eat the Nike, the other air position, which Abbas can be just to just feel your life to be able to take him.
Friend, you had got up? Yes. Ask your question. Your question I'll try to answer in my concluding remarks, so don't mind if that's not answered right now. No, no, one question only. Please decide which one is more important.
My question is to Ali. Is national interest the last right for deciding what type of relations we must share with the new nation?
Okay.
As I said earlier also, that we have, India has maintained a neutral policy, 99 policy in all the countries in the world, but not at the cost of the interest of the nation. Nation is supreme, and in every deal, in every relation, we always see the interest of the country, and the interest of the country must be maintained. That is our motto, our principle. So, it is the principle and motto of every nation, every country, that its own interest must be first. So, India has never sacrificed its own interest, and we have never interfered in the interest of others, unless they have not first interfered into our interests. So, there is no doubt, obviously, national interest is always first.
Can I ask
a question?
Yes,
sir.
It is right that national interests are supreme. You know that in organization of Islamic countries, OIC, Iran has always been working against India on Kashmir issue resolutions. Not once, not twice, but there are as many as 17 resolutions, and all 17 times Iran voted against India. But at the same time, let me share with you that Iran voted against India in the OIC, and the meeting was over. The Iranian delegate came out and straight away ran to the Indian ambassador and told the Indian ambassador, this is formality, this is under coercion, this is under the scare, but our relations are what they are.
Ek minute, all questions are over. Professor Munir Alam would like to answer your question, friend.
Regarding your question about India's imports of hydrocarbon resources, I'll from Iran. You say India is not concentrated only on hydrocarbon resources itself. There are other segments, there are other areas where India is actively participating for Iran. If you will see, this Central Asian, regarding the Central Asian relations, India has making a massive infrastructure development both in Iran and Afghanistan. So there are other areas where India is also trying to to make its engagement in Iran.
Thank you.
Now the question and answer session is formally over. And I am friend standing in front of you as the chief guest of seminar. And I've been asked to share my views with you. Janab Hassan Khan Sahab, Member Parliament, Professor Kashinath Panta Sahab, Sheikh Mohammadi Sahab, Professor Munir Alam, Dr. Jafar Khan, distinguished guests, and my young friends. Before I start sharing my views about Indo-Iran relations, I like to say something about my attachment with Kargil. And my interaction with the Islamia school there. I started my service. My first posting was in Kargil, a subdivision magistrate. 38 years ago, you can imagine Kargil of 1974. In terms of J&K, it used to be almost like this, a kala pani bhej diya isko. But both me and my wife, we have enjoyed, I think the finest part of our professional life was those 2 years that we spent there. And it was in Kargil that I came in touch with the Islamia school. The government educational institution was then spreading in Kargil. There was no college at that time. We will not even talk of a college. There was no college in Leh. And Islamia school at that time was certainly the premium education institution in Kargil. And they played a very, very prominent, very significant role in educating and spreading the education. As Khan Sahab has mentioned, a very pertinent and very important point that on one side they were deeply religious people and the other they were totally secular. And as the governments and private initiatives started spreading in Kargil, I think very sensibly the Islamia school also diversifies its activities. And I'm very happy to note that in the process of that diversification and reaching to the much wider audience, the seminar has been organized in Jammu University. I think I must pay a compliment to the management of the Islamia school for having taken this initiative. And my personal friendship with Khan Sahab. For the last 2 weeks, I'm under a very heavy dose of antibiotics. I'm not undertaking any speaking assignment. But our old contacts, our old friendships, starts right from 74 onwards, I couldn't say no to Khan Saab. And I'm mentioning this because if there are breaks in my speech, please forgive me for that. Now, as a student of history, I would take a very, very broad overview of Indo-Iranian relationships. Where do we start from? I will not go into the scriptures. I will not go into what is written in our epics and what is written in the Persian epics. There are believers, there are non-believers. I'll start from hard historical facts that are recorded and verifiable. And the first is, as learned Professor Pandita mentioned, our origin. The Indo-Aryan race and the Iranian, their link is common. So we have derived both the nations, both the civilizations have derived from the same source. That is the, I think, the strongest and the oldest link that we have. The second, the historical connection, the historical interaction, the two-way traffic, started with the invasion of Alexander. Because both the Persian Empire and at least the northwestern borders of India were affected by that invasion. And after Alexander was no more, the route that he had opened, that route culminated or resulted into a huge flow, two-way flow, of all kinds of ideas, literary ideas, religious ideas, sculptures, art, culture, everything of that kind. And it started in 326 BC. And the most, I think, very aptly summed up by Pandit Nehru in his Glimpses of World History, the Indo-Iranian link. And he says it in one small paragraph, and I like to quote that paragraph. He says, of Iran, and I quote, "The country whose soul is said to have come to India and found a worthy body here in the Taj." This one small paragraph explains the entire give and take between Iran and India in terms of all kinds of interactions at various levels. Then we were no more independent. And Iran started having its problem in the 20th century, what the students of history and political science will know as a great game played by the two superpowers of the world of that time, the Great Britain and the Tsarist Russia. And Iran was getting squeezed from both sides. And then oil was discovered. So Iran also became victim of the greed of the colonial system. And in 1901, one Englishman managed to get 60 years lease to exploit the oil resources of Iran. And the British Anglo-Persian Oil Company has been the biggest source of drain of Iranian wealth in the from that year onwards till the beginning of the Second World War. But then, as in life, nothing remains constant, things change. We became two independent nations, and our relationship was restored back to the earlier historical, cultural, and traditional lines. What I find interesting is, and that, my friend, answers your question about the oil. There is the topic, and there is a sub-theme written in smaller red letters, thicker than oil. Indo-Iran relationship is thicker than oil. Oil is important. Our energy needs are important, and Iran does play a very important role. But let me assure you, if tomorrow, somehow, hypothetically speaking, there's no oil in Iran, all the oil in Iran gets dried up, our relationship with Iran will still remain strong. And that is the hard basis, that is the sound basis, the sound foundations on which the two countries' relationship has been found. Right from 1947, there was Shah's rule earlier, followed in 79 by the Islamic Revolution. There has been a small period of cooling off of our relationships. That notwithstanding, I think it's a very strong relationship, and we must maintain that kind of a relationship. In the current perspective, there are national interests, and these interests and interdependence would change from, if not from year to year, at least from decades to decades. And as of now, our need for Iran may on the surface appear to be more, but Iran's own need for India is also no less. If you look at the world scenario, what is Saudi Arabia trying to do to get better of Iran? Supported by very strong friends. And this struggle is currently, since they are not prepared to take it in Iran, this struggle is currently being played out in Syria. I'm not even for a minute saying I'm pro Mr. Assad or anti Mr. Assad, but under what is happening, what appears to be happening, there is this struggle to contain or at least push Iran to the corner. And it is that context that India's refusal to join the sanctions against Iran must be seen. It's a long-term investment. Yes, energy security may be one. That is not the only reason. I am sure Americans would have assured India that if you follow what we are saying, we will make sure your energy needs are met through different sources. It's not only for energy that India has refused to go along with the sanctions on Iran, there are other reasons also. And for geopolitical reasons also we need Iran, some of which have been mentioned. One point that has not been mentioned, I'd like to flag that issue, and that is Afghanistan. We have all kinds of interests in Afghanistan, all kinds of interests. And most importantly is geostrategic interest. It's a different subject by itself, so I will not go into those details. How do we reach Afghanistan? Through Pakistan is not possible. Through Central Asian Republics is also not possible, because the northern area is not with us. But we can reach Afghanistan through Iran. That is yet another reason for our maintaining good, strong, cordial relations with Afghanistan. But as I mentioned earlier, that these two countries are not just two countries as nation states are understood in the modern world. These two are civilizations, ancient, two of the most ancient civilizations. And the links are civilizational links, the links are foundational links. We cannot sever these links, we cannot forget these links, we cannot ignore these links. And it is these links to keep in mind whenever we talk of Indo-Iran relations, whether in the past or whether making future projections. These, like Pakistan and China, they say our relations are higher than the mountains and deeper than the sea. We'll see after 10, 20 years how high the mountain is and how deep the sea is. But that is not the case between us and the Iranians. Our roots are entwined together. We may appear different on the surface. And those roots will always remain entwined. That's the only thing that must be kept in mind whenever discussing Indo-Iranian relationship. The last point before I close, that in this world, one should never take anything for granted. There will always be ups and downs. The sea remains the same level of water, but you see there's turbulence in the sea also. At times the sea is calm, at times the sea generates tsunami. So whereas the Indo-Iranian relationships is such that over a long period nothing will shake it, but during the short run there could be turbulence. And what we must do, we means both in India as well as in Iran, we must try to avoid these turbulences. We must try to make sure that this sea always remains calm. And I'm sure interactions like this, brainstorming sessions like this that we have been taking part in the last 3 hours or so, are small incremental dosage of help to maintain this relationship on an even key, to keep this sea of storm, to keep the relationship going in a steady and strong manner. I think that is what is important for people like us, people who are currently living in this world. Whatever has happened in the past has happened. What is going to come in the future, we can only predict. What we have with us today, let us make sure that both India and Iran, for their own national interests, for the interest of their people, and also because of the old civilizational links, we keep our interaction, we keep our relationship on a very, very sound and strong footing. Thank you very much.